Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to spend the better part of an hour now to talk to you a little bit about adhesives and their use in the world, and with a particular spin on how they have or how can they assist us in our travelling and various endeavours. So basically, I just thought. I'll just say a little bit about myself before we start. I started my professional career as a as undergraduate chemist actually, and then spent a number of years doing a master's and PhD in the field of surface science, spectroscopy and catalysis on surfaces. And little did I know that a number of years on that attraction of surfaces would bring me back almost full circle to the use of adhesives and adhesion science. So basically, I've been at TWI for just over 25 years now, working in a very large over a wide range of projects, mostly related to adhesion, adhesives. And related matters. So, really, from fighter jets through to syringes, shuttlecocks, you name it. I've been involved in the in work with external clients, assisting in these matters. So, it's always a bit of a challenge when you start off and thinking about a presentation is how do you condense a lot of knowledge into a small amount of time. So hopefully today we'll be able to at least touch on some areas, provoke some thoughts, some discussion, and realize how pervasive adhesive technology is in society, and the fact that it's actually been around for an awful long time too. So really, I just wanted to very quickly touch on TWI, who we are, what we do, before moving on to really the sort of the primary focus of the talk, which is about adhesion, how adhesives actually stick, some historical background, you know, how long have adhesives been with us, how long have we been using them. And then really just touch on sort of three general or specific applications, I should say, which I've been involved with. But again, this really is only at the tip of the iceberg. Oh, sorry about that. No, I can't turn the phone off. Sorry. The vagaries of working from home. Apologies. So we talk a little bit about some applications, and then a bit about what TWI is doing in this field, in particular in relation to plasma technology. Some thoughts about confidence in adhesives, how we use them, and how confident we feel in where they're being used, and how this drives industrial. Applications, and then just finish with some final thoughts. So, without any more ado, this is TWI, our head office in Abingdon, and I'm actually privileged to actually have my seat right in this window here. So, quite lucky to get a nice view on the lake. Allows me to mull in looking over lovely surroundings. So TWI essentially is an engineering consultancy, which is based, membership based, and we basically endeavour to support our customers, our members, in all aspects of engineering, but in particular with an emphasis on the joining aspect. So our original name, we're often known, still known as the Welding Institute, is one strand of what we do, but we cover all other aspects in terms of engineering materials and joining technologies. We've been around for quite a long time, since 1946. In fact, this year is our 75th anniversary, and we're very active in all fields, especially training as well, consultancy. Very much UK based, but we have international offices. And as you can see, large, very highly qualified staff, a lot of engineers. I tend to say we're an SME. And as I mentioned about membership, we have, and it varies, but around about 700 industrial members worldwide. So we have a very broad client base, very broad range of applications in which to work. So essentially, every day is a different day at TWI. No 2 days, no two customer requirements are ever the same. Mentioned briefly about the TWI offices. Essentially, we're based in Cambridge. But we have a non-destructive evaluation centre in Port Talbot in South Wales. We have a capability in Rotherham, just outside Sheffield, especially in terms of metal additive manufacturing and friction stir welding. We have capability in Middlesbrough, wide-ranging facilities, including one of the larger dive tanks in Europe. So to enable divers to inspect and structures non-destructively, as well as welding operations and the like. And we also have offices in Aberdeen. That's all about TWI. Now on to the main focus, which is really about adhesion. I could spend a lot of time just purely talking about this topic in its purest form, but whilst that is may well be very interesting and relevant to some of you, it really only covers a tiny amount of what I want to say today. So I just really want to focus on the main points, which is that for any adhesive bond to be successful, it has to interact with the surface. So really, that's the most important aspect of adhesion. If we don't have an adequate surface, an adequately prepared surface, then adhesion will not be good. The other thing that we have to remember about adhesive bonding is that an adhesive, in order to interact with the surface, must be a liquid at some point to enable the surface to be wetted, so i.e. to enable intimate contact between the adhesive and the surface to take place. And the way in which this wetting occurs, there are a number of different mechanisms that can be used to describe adhesion. And it probably is fair to say that a combination of some or all of these mechanisms are present in every adhesion interaction. But the main ones, as we can see here, there is physical adsorption. Again, maybe going back to your school days, you may well be aware of van der Waals interactions and hydrogen bonding. And these essentially are very weak bonds which are induced when atoms, molecules come in contact or come in close proximity to other atoms and molecules and reach a point where there is actually a mutual adhesion due to very slight perturbations in the electronic distribution of the electrons around the cloud. So you get a slight positive and a slight negative attraction. So van der Waals forces working at around about 4 angstroms or 0.4 nanometers, very weak but very pervasive, and actually contribute massively to many, many adhesive processes. Then we have the hydrogen bond, which is relates to the dipolar nature of hydrogen and oxygen. Best example is water. So here the slight negativity of the oxygen of one molecule is attracted to the slight positivity of the hydrogen atom on another molecule, which enables these interactions to take place and actually enables water to be water, because if hydrogen bonding wasn't an effect, and basically we wouldn't exist, as all biology wouldn't function in the way it currently does. I should say that, just to show that the traditional bonds that people know about, the traditional high strength covalent bonds are way, way stronger than anything that the physical absorption shows. But That said, for adhesion, these are probably the two main processes. And following on, though, in terms of these mechanisms, we do have chemisorption, which essentially does describe covalent bonds, where we actually have chemical interactions, chemical bonds forming. And then there's more from an engineering perspective, we can get mechanical interlocking. So essentially a rough surface will enable the adhesive to, in simple terms, grab the surface and provide adhesion. And then in some instances, especially with plastics, with polymers, we actually get a diffusion or a molecular motion of the adhesive into the surface of the material to actually form an intimate bond. Diffusion in some instances could be regarded as being very closely related to welding. So there is a grey area between diffusion and bonding and welding, depending on the materials. We have opportunity a number of years ago to invite a gecko into TWI. In fact, it was a pet of a colleague of mine. But geckos, as you probably know, are famous for their ability to walk up walls, walk along ceilings, etc. And they exhibit an amazing property called dry adhesion, which basically they leave no residue on the surface. They really do seem to act like real Spider-Man, so to speak, in terms of what they can do. And in fact, it's known that geckos can even walk up wet glass as well as dry glass. The mechanism behind the adhesion had been speculated at for many, many years, but it wasn't really until the early 2000s, that there was an opportunity to properly investigate this phenomenon. And the person who really gets full credit here is a chap called Keller Autumn. Always intrigues me this, because my surname is really unusual in its spelling. And here's a guy in America who actually uses my surname as his Christian name, which I find quite intriguing. But anyway, Keller Autumn basically showed very careful experimentation that the structure of gecko feet, when you actually zoom in looking at each individual toe, that the toes were covered, as you can see here, and that when you actually then really delved down, you actually found that there was a nanostructure, so each fiber subdivided into smaller components, right down to these little heads here, which are called setae. And basically what Keller Autumn and his team showed was that it was the actual interaction of these nanopads with the surface that basically resulted in Van der Waals attraction, sufficient such that the gecko got enough adhesion to walk up walls. And in fact, it was shown really that a gecko really only needed adhesion in theory from one toe would be sufficient to carry its weight. And basically a number of amazing factors have been determined from this work in terms of the actual physical forces of adhesion that's induced. But as ever with these things, it's never quite as simple or as easily breakdownable as one might like to think. So when this structure was first determined, there was a great rush to see whether a synthetic analog could be produced that would enable us to have dry adhesion, maybe even have real life Spider-Man, spider suits, gloves that you could do amazing things with. And this is an example of one of the early types of adhesive. This was actually grown, carefully produced in a very, very demanding environment. I believe these were silicone actual microfeatures with equivalent sized heads, which did show a level of adhesion. And this, I think, what came out of Manchester and UMIST, and all the media at the time was this little Spider-Man model with his hand stuck to the glass. Now, unfortunately, we've not seen much evolution from one or two press releases into something that's real. Basically, because what was subsequently found was that, as ever with nature, things are more complex than they seem. So whilst these heads, these very fine features, are very flexible, it is only part of the story. So how does the gecko unstick itself when it walks up the wall? Well, the shape of each of these setae and the angle at which they are to the actual structure enables them to be peeled off very effectively. And also that it's a composite structure. So whilst this area is very soft and flexible, there's actually a higher degree of stiffness in there along the full length of the fibre, which again enables the mechanics of adhesion and then debonding to take place effectively and repeatedly. So as ever, it's never always just one factor. There's often a number of contributing elements to this. So there's a fair bit of work still required to fully mimic what a gecko can do. But I think it's also quite interesting to note that another function of the gecko feet was that whilst this structure enables van der Waals bonding to take place, the chitin, the material that's used, similar to our fingernails actually, that is used to make these structures, is actually highly hydrophobic as well. So it actually repels water and is essentially self-cleaning. And again, this is a function of the ability for a property to be used in a completely opposite fashion. So from a gecko structure, we can actually go from sticky to unsticky. And the lotus leaf is a really good example of this, which is when you actually zoom down to the nanoscale, we actually see that the leaf comprises hundreds of millions of little bumps. And actually on each bump, there is actually nano features, which actually contribute to creating an air gap between water and the surface and repel the materials. So the material's water repellent, but also the structure further aids that. So here we have the same structure, in this instance, resulting in total water repellency, whereas with the gecko, it both uses it to be adhesive, but also water repellent at the same time. So as ever, we can learn a lot by looking around us, looking at nature. Now, geckos don't have the complete monopoly on adhesive processes. There are many, many different types of adhesive mechanisms that insects have been using for millions of years. And again, I'm not going to go through all of this. You can look back at this at your leisure, but the majority of other insect-based systems tend to be not so much van der Waals-based, but more actually creating sticky substances which will enable adhesion to a surface and inevitably will leave inevitable trails or residue behind. So as I said, there's a very large number of systems going on here, at least 12 that are known about. I think it does mean that whenever you see a fly walking over your food, just remember that it's not leaving a clean trail of footprints. So it will be leaving residues of one shape or form on anything you subsequently eat. Why do insects use adhesives? Well, I think, again, pretty obvious, a whole range of functions from locomotion to basically addressing predators, building retreats, prey, defence, etc., etc. So basically a whole range of functions, which then I guess nicely segues on to what do we use glue for. Now I have a very good friend of mine, colleague of mine, who is very pedantic about the use of words, and he often teases me about the fact that I get a bit squirmy when I hear people use the word glue rather than adhesive. So I thought I'd tackle this head on, and I delved online to sort of see whether I could address this once and for all. But as ever, life is never simple. So my understanding, and certainly if you look at a number of dictionaries and websites, when you use the term glue, it's generally what one perceives that you would get from melting or boiling up animal bones and skins to make books and other types of furniture adhesive in the past. However, even the Cambridge Online Dictionary just says it's a sticky substance as well, and it can also be from a chemical process. Another adhesive manufacturer I looked at basically just muddles it further by just saying that an adhesive is a substance for use for sticking objects together, such as glue, cement, or paste. So I have to, I won't say admit defeat, but I certainly would, I'm certainly not going to get into an argument with people who keep insisting in using the word glue, though personally I still think adhesive is a better, more technical term to use. But I'll leave it at that there and move on. But I just thought I wanted to address that issue. Okay, so it wouldn't be fair to basically fly the flag for adhesives to say that I think it's probably safe for me to say that it's the adhesive technology is probably the oldest manufacturing activity in the world. And this was compounded by some work done a number of years ago where a Neo-Paleolithic excavation unearthed a number of stone tools which also had some resinous tar that was attached to them. And carbon dating of the area basically showed that these were certainly over 200,000 years old, and that this resin that was on here, it was actually produced from birch bark tar, which is essentially a material that had been known about for a long time in terms of Stone Age activities, but not as far back as this. What makes this most interesting, though, is that along with the challenge of making birch bark tar, this resin was then, I've been shown to be compounded with various other elements, including sand and other fibrous materials to actually make it a much more usable, more effective material. So essentially, this wasn't just something that had been gathered and used straight away, it actually had been processed. And the number of tools that have subsequently been found with this shows that it was really almost a little industry to make this stuff. You couldn't just get a little bit of birch bark and extract what you need and then move on. You would actually need a team of people to actually produce this. So I think we can probably say that this certainly at the moment takes the number one spot for being the oldest process. And in fact, the production of birch bark tar has been investigated quite thoroughly by a range of people over the years. There's a very interesting article by Mike Richardson where he actually goes into the actual process of making it. And it's not trivial. Basically, it's not just birch sap. It actually is the bark which has to be gathered. It then has to be heated in a controlled way. Obviously, if you're Neolithic times, it would have to be over a fire. But you have to extract it, so you can't just have one container. You have to have some way of catching the liquid as it is driven out of the bark by the fire. So again, a fiddly process. The primary constituent is a compound called betulum, which it has thermoplastic properties, and basically it's solid at room temperature, but once it gets a bit warmer, you can start to mold it make it as a putty, but sort of 60 degrees, and then it boils at about 180 degrees. So basically, this is a real process. It is done today in some instances, but is not an insignificant challenge. Since that time, though, again, I could give you a whole talk just purely on the history of adhesives. So again, very potted rush through the sort of the main milestones in adhesive technology. Essentially, we have start off with birch or tree derived systems, and also naturally occurring pitch deposits were also used for adhesives, and then bitumen cements, and then other animal and plant products such as casein, which is a protein from milk, was used in Egyptian times and earlier. And then we have other plant extracts, which are basically the primary base of sugar and starch, very much the sticky elements. And as I've mentioned, there's also the protein-based in terms of collagen, egg, blood, the glues that I referred to earlier in terms of animal products, very popular in earlier times. The sort of the interesting activities from a chemistry point of view really only start kicking in the early Victorian period, initially with rubber-based products, and then phenolic resins, and then synthetic rubbers. A bit of rediscovery in terms of some products. So basically, again, First World War, there was a resurgence in the discovery of the protein-based systems. But really, it was really from the 20s onwards that all of the systems that we are much more familiar with have been synthesized and improved upon. Though interestingly, really, there's not been an awful lot of new chemistry developed since really the 1980s. Everything nowadays is a hybrid of a lot of these chemistries. So the epoxies, the phenolics, the cyanoacrylates, and others, silicones as well, are now all, there's lots and lots of active hybrids, very, very few new chemistries. But I thought it just worthwhile, again, just touching on the where these adhesives have found use. So stone tools to Egyptian inlaying and woodworking through to the Industrial Revolution. And then probably one of the biggest, most significant sectors in using adhesives from a structural perspective really has to be the advent of flight. And here we have the Wright brothers' inaugural flight. It's a very famous picture. But basically their aircraft and subsequent aircrafts right up until the 20s really, or 20s, 30s, were of wooden and natural materials for building these craft. So wooden structure, all laminated, bonded together, often canvas skins for the wing structure, the propellers very much built from laminated, bonded materials. And basically this was the way very much for the manufacturing production of aircraft really up until the Second World War, and then after that period, the advent of civilian air transport, or the mass development of it, meant that the engineers started to get real cold feet about using adhesives on their own. How could they be sure that they would last or be strong enough? And there was a big move away towards metal structures and the use of fasteners and fastening systems, which still really continues till this day, even though adhesives are used extensively, there's usually always still a requirement for fasteners, rivets there regardless. One area though where adhesives are still very pervasive in aircraft structures as the primary structural element though is in honeycomb structures. So again, often called sandwich structures, where we will have a skin, a top and bottom skin. And in this instance, an aluminium honeycomb is produced which is then bonded top and bottom of the skin using a film of adhesive to form essentially a complete structure, which is incredibly stiff and very, very light. And this can be crafted through a bit of clever manufacturing into a range of structures like this leading edge of a wing. But it's also used for the flooring and decking of aircraft and numerous other areas of application. So adhesives are used extensively in this. In fact, without adhesives, you wouldn't really be able to produce such materials, such sandwich structures. Other areas where adhesives are very, very pervasive, the automotive sector, is essentially probably true to say that there are several kilograms of adhesive in every modern car that comes off the production line in an incredibly large number of areas, from weld bonding or a combination of spot welding and adhesives in the actual underlying structure through to bonding of, again, major structural elements like the windscreen. So all windscreens now are structurally bonded into the chassis, and there's no rubber seal like there was in older cars. And the windscreen actually produces creates a key structural element in the whole vehicle in terms of enhancing stiffness. Additionally, it might interest you to know that for certainly the last 20, 30, probably longer years, all brake shoes and all clutch pads have been adhesively bonded in place with the use of rivets being discounted many years ago. So you literally are putting your hands in an adhesive bonding technology. Obviously, the failure rate of such a process is incredibly small, but this is as much about getting the right design elements, so using the adhesive in the right way, and also making sure that your manufacturing process is as tight as it can possibly be. From more general engineering, we are familiar with thread locking adhesives, which will hold fasteners, nuts, bolts, etc. together, stop them from loosening over time. We can then move on to other more modern adhesives like superglues, the cyanoacrylate families, which are used in a multitude of applications, ranging from electronics, also cars actually. So often the rear view mirror can be adhesively bonded into the windscreen using cyanoacrylate, so it certainly can in some applications. But also such materials are also found now used extensively in medical applications such as catheters, syringes, etc. And even in the more extreme area of addressing aneurysms, where there is now a product that has been designed to be actually injected directly into an aneurysm, a swollen blood vessel in the brain, to actually stop the aneurysm developing into or stop it rupturing. And by virtue of the fact that the super glue cures instantly in contact with blood. So basically this is a complex procedure using a long catheter fed through the heart and up into the brain. But it has been shown to be extremely effective. And I really can't go anywhere without mentioning certainly both satellites, which use a lot of adhesives, and also mobile phones. And if any of you enjoy taking mobile phones apart, putting new batteries and new screens, you'll probably curse all the adhesives that are in there now, because basically sticky tape seems to be one of the primary mechanisms for assembly, but also to actually seal the structures up to make them waterproof, which makes them even harder to dismantle. My job is very much based around clients asking advice on what adhesives that can be used for different applications. And I think it'd be fair to say that there's probably several hundred, probably several thousand adhesives available worldwide, and just make life even more complex. They are described in a myriad of different ways. So we can talk about an adhesive in terms of its chemistry. So is it an epoxy or a polyurethane or an acrylic? We can talk about it in terms of its physical form. Is it a liquid adhesive, a paste adhesive, a film adhesive? We often talk about adhesives, or they're described in terms of how you might want to apply it. So it may be that it's a electrically conducting adhesive, or a transparent adhesive, or some other property that is specific to that application. Cure mechanisms, so is it a heat cure system or is it a pressure sensitive system? So it's very common there for people to start describing adhesives, for example, you know, as a single part heat curing electrically conducting epoxy paste adhesives. So it's a real old mouthful, as a result can result in a lot of confusion, especially when all you want is something to do the job in hand and for it to last. I think it'd be fair to say that most adhesives are polymeric in nature, so they require some sort of organic chemistry system to work. They're not totally, but the vast majority are of this type of system, of which there are basically thermoplastic adhesives and thermosets. The primary difference there really is that thermoplastic systems, by virtue of the fact that they require heat to melt and to bond and then set, they are essentially reversible, whereas thermoset systems are irreversible in their nature. And driving all of this, two of the most common questions that I'm asked is how strong is the adhesive going to be, and how long will it last? So how durable will the adhesive bond be? And these are not often easy questions to answer, as I'll touch on a little bit later. Along with the adhesive types, it's probably fair to say that we also have to be pragmatic and understand why would we want to use an adhesive in the first place, because with every positive, there's usually a negative. I'll start with the negatives first, because it's always better to end on a high note. So essentially, I mentioned before, adhesives require surfaces to be appropriately prepared for adhesion to work effectively. So you have to prepare your materials, your surfaces, to get the results you want. And then there's the frustration of curing time. I mean, how many times have you tried to stick a handle on your mug with a bit of epoxy resin and or a super glue, and you want to try it out immediately, and the minute you suck it together and it doesn't work. So curing time, being patient, waiting is key. And this is very important if you're trying to work in a high pressure, high volume manufacturing environment. You need to get the right curing time to satisfy your needs. All adhesives are chemicals, therefore they have a certain element of hazard associated with them. The vast majority of adhesives do, because sometimes the individual components are not particularly pleasant to handle, and can have health and safety issues, or they may well go off in time in terms of reacting with oxygen, etc. So basically, there's always a drive to actually try and make the adhesive safer, but it's an inherent issue that we have to be aware of. You've got to hold the structures together while they cure. Then you also need to think about the non-destructive assessment. So can you assess how strong an adhesive is going to be without having to test it all the time? And there may well be a need to modify the joint design from what you originally had planned, if it was, say, a welded structure or a mechanically fastened structure. So those are the sort of the negatives. The positives, though, are amazing. So essentially, we can join anything to anything, basically, with the right type of adhesive and the right approach. So the opportunities for manufacturing, for assembling, are almost limitless. If we only use an adhesive and we avoid fasteners and other things, we can take the weight of a structure down. We can reduce stresses around joints, which is always important. By and large, these are cold processes. even you know, heating up to say 200 degrees C for certain types of epoxies, if you're joining metals, this is a cold process. So you've got real flexibility here. And by virtue of having no or low stresses, we can have a very fatigue resistant structure. And because we're using materials which don't require or require little input and energy, we don't have heating costs, which means that efficiency of the assembly is high, along with the fact that we can save energy when we're transporting structures by virtue of weight reduction. So I think there's an awful lot of positives for adhesives over other methods. But it's a process, and we have to consider a number of different stages to ensure that we get the end result that we wish. So basically there's a design activity and there's a manufacturing activity. And we could spend a lot of time over all of these areas, but I just want to highlight the fact that there are these different stages. They're all equally important and really shouldn't be ignored wherever possible. And my job, my day job, is really to help clients in all of these areas. I touched on design. Just really to highlight the fact that the main type of joint, the main data value that you will see on most structural adhesive data sheets is single lap shear or lap shear strength. A lap joint is basically two sheets overlapping and bonded in between. And this value, which is often regarded often quoted as almost as a lap shear strength, really should be treated with a lot of caution, because it's not really a shear a loading. As you can see in this finite element simulation, which is slightly magnified, because of the asymmetry of the joint, you actually get a bending of the actual substrates, which causes a change in the stress at the ends of the joint here, and is shown typically in this perspex example, shown through polarized light. Very high stresses at the end, very low stresses in the middle. And as a consequence, it means that the overall value is not really representative of a true shear strength value. Luckily, it's more conservative. So the stresses you see at the ends are much, much higher than the average shear strength that's quoted. But it really must be emphasized that this type of joint, whilst it's very commonly used, really is not an engineering approved structure on which to base calculations, but you will see it everywhere. I mentioned also about designing. It's not, if you're going to bond, you need to think about bonding, not welding or fastening. And an example I think really highlights this really nicely is the fact that if we have an angle, and this might be a bracket for holding a shelf on or whatever, if we were going to screw this in place, we may well have it in this orientation where we basically maybe put some screws, or if this was a steel structure, we might weld it in place, which is great for those types of joining processes. However, from a bonding point of view, this is not good, because if you think about applying a load here, we're putting a tensile, a cleavage load right at this point here, very high stress, and a much reduced shear load along the length of the bond. So all the load is being carried, or most of it's being carried at this point rather than across the load. And this is got a high chance of failure. If we just turn this bracket around by flip it in the other direction, so now we have this type of assembly and we bond in this way, what we now find is the loading now, due to a bending moment here, puts this part into compression and actually enables much greater proportion of the load to be carried in shear. And we can get potentially an order of magnitude improvement in overall load carrying capacity just by turning a bracket upside down, or the right way up, however you want to regard it. On to the examples I wanted to just touch with you on. So the first one that I thought would be interesting is the Lotus Elise. Quite an old car now, originally launched in the very early 90s, and basically was quite a revolution in its day, because it's basically underneath the chassis, which is generally fiberglass composite material, is an aluminium tub, an aluminium chassis, which is basically all bonded together, adhesively bonded, and that's the main structural loading capacity. What makes it very innovative, though, is that whilst the chassis is made from aluminium, bonding aluminium effectively can be a real challenge, and especially in the auto sector, where perhaps the luxury of time is not available. So what am I talking about here? Well, aluminium has a challenging surface oxide, which in many respects is brilliant if you want to have a system which resists adhesion, resists corrosion, because this natural oxide instantly forms around bare metal. However, it's been shown time and time again that if you bond to freshly braided aluminium, the actual bonds are not durable, especially not in hot, wet environments. And the reason for this is basically because the oxide will react with water and it forms various hydroxides, which have a larger free volume than the unreacted oxide. And basically this creates a hydraulic effect, so it can cause a failure to the interface. So basically a bonded aluminium structure where all you've done is abrade the joints and left it outside, there's a very high chance that the structure will fail before too long. And you really need to be very aware of that as an issue. And this has been known about for a very long time, and I sort of probably just rather sweepingly said it's probably several man centuries have been devoted to pre-treating aluminium, basically because of to address this. So basically there are a wide range of options that have been considered, which again I'll just touch on briefly, in terms of you can do abrasion, or you can have wet processes or dry processes. But in order to enable this bonding to this, you have to do something, otherwise you're going to have a real problem. I'm aware I'm sort of running out of time, so I'm going to have to try and speed up now. I must apologise for this. But please do send in your questions and we'll pick up on them at the end of this at the end of this webinar, if not live, certainly after the event. So basically, we've got an issue with aluminium where wet processes, the traditional ones using chromium, are now banned. And the modern processes which have been developed to replace chromium are still energy intensive and are not perfect. And when we look in the automotive sector, basically the volume production means that such processes are too slow anyway. So basically for auto applications, it would be good if we can have adhesives which are just tolerant of the surface, or a pretreatment which is effective and is very robust. And what was done with the Elise was that the pretreatment, which is a specific type of anodizing, was developed that was much, much more robust than the traditional methodologies, and as a consequence enabled a heat cure epoxy to be used very effectively to bond directly to the material. This is a secret recipe. It's strong, it's durable, it actually breaks all of the rules in terms of what you should be doing for bonding aluminium, but essentially it does work and is very, very effective. This is the actual tub here. The second application is in work we've done with the RNLI. Basically, they're the guys and girls who go out and rescue everyone in all weathers in very high sea environments. And basically here, adhesive bonding is absolutely critical for all that the RNLI do, because they design and build all their own craft. And these craft are being designed to last for 50 years plus these days. And they're experts in this, very much all composite construction these days. It's the combining of all the different materials in the right areas to provide the correct properties that enable these craft to be almost unsinkable. And certainly recent work they've done, where they've actually shown that some of the slam loadings that they're seeing on the hulls of these craft can be greater than 13G in size, which is absolutely enormous. It's like, would be very hard to tolerate. You need special seating when you're actually in one of these things. But very, very robust, especially when you think that composites generally are assumed to be rather poor in terms of resisting impact. But as you might imagine, this has to be accommodated for in the manufacturing operations. So here we can see these craft being produced actually in one of the shipyards down in Lymington, down on the south coast in England. And inevitably, when you are working in such aggressive environments, you will get damage. And again, the beauty of composite materials and adhesives is that these damages can be repaired, as we can see here. And we've worked extensively with RNLI in a number of different areas, especially in repair, and looking at how we can affect these repair solutions really effectively. Finally, Bloodhound, supersonic car. Sadly, I think that whole project's been parked for the time being because of COVID. But essentially what we did at TWI is we worked in partnership with Swansea University and National Composite Centre in a programme to develop and look at the selection of adhesives for bonding some aspects of the chassis structure. What we basically found was that whilst we got some very strong adhesives at high temperatures, a lot of adhesives were much weaker when we increased the temperature. So this is room temperature, this is at 150 degrees. And even when we found adhesives which were effective at higher temperatures, as effective as they were at room temperature, we were then constrained by the temperature which could cure the material. And ultimately what this meant was that whilst one should be curing at 120 degrees, we actually had to cure right down at 85 in order to avoid any thermal expansion effects due to the mixed materials being used in the actual chassis. So here the materials were driving the adhesive selection in addition to the overall performance requirements. So a lot of work here. And whilst this may well seem rather esoteric in terms of a project, inevitably the technologies that come out of these sorts of endeavours usually filter the way down to much more general purpose applications in the future. Finally, onto plasma. Very briefly, this is essentially the fourth state of matter. The sun is a ball of plasma, but luckily we can have systems which are much cooler than that. Essentially, we've been developing technology here using this type of capability to see if we can pre-treat surfaces, because plasma can very effectively clean surfaces, can also chemically alter a surface, and it can etch as well. So we can actually get a lot of control over how a surface is when we apply it. So our goal, our drive, is to basically replace wet, hot processes with something that is dry and effective and quick. We've been doing this now for a number of years, looking at specifically metals, but also now in composites, to see whether we can really drive this process forward. So this is our equipment. And note here, 40 degrees is our plasma temperature. So we can work with really some quite delicate materials. Basically this shows plasma treating a piece of steel. I'm gonna just fast forward to there because I'm running out of time. So basically the plasma tracked along the surface, but we can change the surface wetting capacity purely by that process, as you can see here, in terms of how the plasma has affected things. We've done work with stainless steel, and we've shown that the best we can do with a wet etch is around about 45 megapascals. We've actually bettered that with plasma, and we're now around about 50 megapascals for a lap shear test. So whilst the caution is on lap shear, but it's a very good comparative measure, we can actually improve the bondability just using a dry process, kind of fraction of the time. And we've done a lot of work looking at what's going on at the surface and how the chemistry of the surface has been changing as well. And we've been actually adding different things. And this is quite a nice schematic showing the plasma, which removes a lot of these surface layers of contamination to get down to the metal oxide, hydroxide, and actually change the chemistry of what's going on here. We've also looked at titanium, and again, just touching on this really, but the most interesting point here is if you take a polished specimen, we can get a lapsia strength of 22 megapascals. If we do the best alkaline etch system on a polished material, we can get 63. We can take a polished material that has nothing other than a plasma treatment, and this is an argon oxygen mix, and we can get comparable strengths purely by using plasma as opposed to a wet process. So plasma really can offer a massive benefit over a lot of conventional systems. And this is ongoing work that we're working hard to develop into the real world. This is another example of the sensitivity of plasma. So as I said, this is a cool plume running along. This is a Gore-Tex fabric example. And what we've done here is just to show that the plasma can actually drive off the water-repelling element of the treatment on the fabric. So we're sort of like undoing the benefit of the system. But it shows, again, we're actually changing the chemistry of what's going on. Finally, confidence. The number of times I hear people say, yeah, I'm stuck together, but do I really feel confident in what's going on? And I have to say that there are lots of possible pitfalls when using adhesives. This summarizes typical sort of concerns one might have in terms of poor curing or porosity or voids, disbonds, etc., cracks. And all of these things potentially could compromise an adhesive bond. But luckily, adhesives are very tolerant, and by and large, most of this can be avoided by just having good, effective quality control and good, effective processes that enable the bond to take place. But, you know, we still got to be very mindful of them to make sure that everything still works effectively. This is a good example of an X-ray image of a lap shear joint, just showing the adhesive. And I think it typifies, this shows how tolerant adhesives are. This would have been a very strong joint. Here we've got some little glass beads which set how thick the bond is. These little black areas are just voids, they're bubbles. There's lots more bubbles because there was a fabric carrier here. But despite all of those holes in that adhesive, this is still a very, very high strength joint. So understanding the effect of such defects is still very much an ongoing research. But I think even in this example, this is still a very effective system. So finally, basically adhesives are incredibly versatile materials. They can be used everywhere. They are used everywhere. But remember, it's not a de-skilling process, so ignore that at your peril. Just getting a tube of glue out of the box and throwing it on a surface and sticking something together is inevitably going to lead to failure at some point. And there are often commercial issues in terms of, you know, using the right adhesive for the right application. So there's a lot more still to understand, despite the maturity of the technology. I mean, hey, 200,000 years, it's quite a long time we've been using these systems. It really is the surface. You've got to make sure your surface is correct. And again, I could and probably will in some time in the future try and have another talk about the modern challenges in terms of how we can use adhesives effectively moving forward, especially reversibility, health and safety, the green elements, etc. Because what's the point of making something you can't take apart if you want to repair it or you want to reuse or recycle it? So these are big issues that are taking up the attention of us and the manufacturers and industry in general at this point in time. But it would be wrong of me not to highlight them as key issues. And finally, just to mention some acknowledgements to various people who've helped contribute to this work. So John Watts and Gary Critchlow of Surrey and Loughborough Universities respectively. David Williams, who did a lot of work with, who's now at Vestas Wind Systems actually. He was my first PhD student working on plasma. Tim Yao is my current PhD student working on the plasma system. Jacob, our technician at TWI, who's helped him an awful lot of the work we've done over the years. AdTech, who done a lot of work with plasma. RNLI, obviously, and Henkel, who all been, we've worked closely with them for as long as I've been in my job, and certainly the technical team there are always second to none. So basically, I'm sorry I've taken a little bit longer than I perhaps had hoped, and that's invariably what I do. So I hope that you've managed to hang on to the end. As I said, if we can stay open, I'll take some questions now. If we can't, then please send them in, and I'll do my best to respond accordingly. So anyway, thank you very much.
Thanks, Ewan. If we have got a few questions, I don't know if you've got time to answer them. The first one is, what is the strongest adhesive for joining metals?
Well, it all depends on what you mean by strong. it's a really good question, and it's one that we often encounter. So I think what you need to be aware of is you have to think about what you're actually trying to do. So adhesives, as I've shown or mentioned, they have many advantages, but they also are a bit sensitive to the way in which they're loaded from a stress point of view. And everyone will know this in terms of, you intuitively know that if you've got something that's stuck to a surface, that the best way to get it off is to pick at an edge and then try and peel it off, because the peeling approach essentially is one of the Achilles heels of adhesives. Whereas if you try to just basically try and pull a plate vertically off of the surface, it would be a real challenge. So likewise, for metals applications, it really depends on what you're trying to do to get the right strength. So, I mean, in terms of just a number, we've achieved lap shear strengths with epoxy aerospace grade adhesives of 60 plus megapascals on a lap shear. So this is a 12.5 millimeter overlap, 25 mil wide. So essentially postage stamp size and bond. And 60 plus megapascals is quite substantial. But if we were to try, that was with 2 millimeter thick titanium. If we were going to bond titanium foil together, then we may well find that that's not the strongest system, basically because you'd then have a lot of flex, a lot of bending in the system, and a very high strength rigid epoxy may well not be the right system for the job, whereas a lower modular system, a polyurethane, for example, or maybe a toughened acrylic, may not give the highest headline value, but may well actually be much, much more tolerant to a more flexible system, or system where compliance is not king. So there isn't really one adhesive. I mean, the epoxies are the workhorse family of adhesives, and they would probably be the go-to ones if you want to sort of your engineering approach. But there are others, and also ones that perform much better at higher temperatures. For example, bismaliamides, polyamides, cyanide ester systems, which will perform adequately at, say, high 200s into the 300 degrees C, whereas epoxies by and large will fail. So it's a bit of a how long is a piece of string question. It's a very good one, but it really does depend on the application.
Okay, there are still quite a few questions. I don't know if people are happy to stay on. We've got another. It says, what are the challenges in digital adhesive joining to address the drive towards industry 4.0?
Oh, that's an interesting one. And a difficult one to answer succinctly. I think it, because I'm not a Industry 4.0 expert, but I think that there is a much greater appreciation and understanding of adhesive bonding now from a modeling point of view than there was even, say, 10 years ago. Although there's still quite a way to go to be completely confident in all the predictions that such models can generate. But I think that the advent of improved modeling enables one to make a better optimization of both the amount of adhesive and its placement, its location, as well as, say, the bond line thickness, all of which is very much going to be part of the controlled manufacturing environment, because it's really that aspect of control control of all the parameters, especially dimensions and location, which really will drive the effectiveness of an adhesive bond and adhesive bonding system onwards. I mean, just think about how far we've still got to go when you think that all adhesives at the moment are isotropic materials. You just stick, you basically apply it, and by and large, with one or two very specific exceptions, an adhesive is just an amorphous blob of stuff which holds two substrates together. And then you think about where we were with thermoplastic polymers. Polyethylene is a brilliant example, whereas when it was first developed, low density polyethylene, amorphous blob of stuff which you molded into whatever component you wanted. And we've gone from there to ultra-orientated, ultra-high molecular weight systems where now Dyneema and equivalent materials enough are now made, used and implemented, which have, again, great claims, but you know, are strong as steel, can be made into bulletproof material, have incredible level of anisotropy that enables the properties to be fully realized. We haven't started with adhesives yet, but I do see a time in the future where controlling the adhesive, not just at a macro level, but also at a micro, even a nano level, will be really significant in ultimately getting the most out of it. And that's all going to be very much hand in hand with the digital revolution and evolution as we move forward.
Thanks, Ewan. There's about five more questions.
I'll keep them coming.
Oh, okay, then fine. Okay, so the next one is, what are the non-destructive method to assess the adhesive bond quality?
People are asking good questions. Again, it's a challenging area. I mean, and it depends on what you mean by bond quality. There was some slides I took out of this presentation because I knew I was going to overrun regardless, and I would have done even more so if I'd left them in, to address this whole thing called the kissing bond, which is this zero volume disbond, i.e. when an adhesive doesn't really stick to a surface for no apparent reason, but you can't measure that by any conventional methodology. That drives a whole quality of bond question such that, it, to my knowledge, at this point in time, I know of no definitive method to non-destructively or in a non-contact way measure this or define the strength of an adhesive without actually physically testing it, so actually destructively testing it. So I think that the quality you can get is you can look for consistency of a mix. You can do things like X-ray or ultrasonic methods to look for to ensure that there are no inconsistencies in the response of the adhesive to those technologies, to those probing mechanisms, of which there are many. But all they will show is that the adhesive perhaps is mixed correctly, or that there is an absence of voids or no cracks, etc. So you can get a lot of capability to assess that element of an adhesive. But to actually verify that a bond is going to give you a lap shear strength of 35.7 megapascals, no. At the moment, there is no methodology that I'm aware of that can do that.
Okay. You'll have to bear with me with the next one because I'm not sure about the pronunciation. We have a challenge right now where we have been approached to dispense large volumes of a dual curing cyan acrylate material. The challenge is how or what contact material can be used to prevent internal premature curing within the dispenser.
Yeah, that's especially if it's a dual cure cyan acrylate based system. In some ways, this is one you almost have to go back to the manufacturer, because if they've got a product which they say can be dispensed in this way, then they really should be taking up the responsibility of ensuring it can be dispensed. From a without knowing any more details, the sorts of materials you're going to be restricted to look for a non-stick base, obviously, are the polyolefins, so polypropylene, polyethylene, PTFE or PTFE coatings are common substrates that are often used to stop adhesion. Silicone as well potentially can stop adhesion. But it really will depend on the nature of the chemistry of the adhesive and what other processes might be required, because there are different ways you can improve the non-stickability of a surface, but it would depend on that. So it's a challenge, and that's why normally cyan alkylates are dispensed as single part systems rather than dual cure. But I'm aware of these dual cure systems now, which are sort of hybrids. Again, if whoever's put the question wants to, I'll have the details hopefully, or if they want to send me the details, then I'm more than happy to discuss it in more detail offline.
Yeah, I can send you the list of the questions. That's not a problem. Do you have experience on the damping characteristics of different adhesives? I have a special application in mind where we would need low damping at frequencies in low ultrasonic range, 20 to 300 kilohertz.
Personally, that's not an area I have much knowledge of, but TWI has a significantly extensive expertise. Pardon my English, that's terrible. We're pretty good at ultrasonics and that type of technology, and I have no doubt that that would be a collaboration between myself and some of our NDT colleagues who work in the ultrasonics section to take that sort of thing on board and look and see how we could address it. Because as I said, it's my strengths are in looking for and identifying the right sort of materials and material properties, but I don't know what those properties would be. So that's where I would be looking at the expertise of my colleagues in NDT to support me in that. So I think that would be a sort of combined effort, but not one that I don't think we certainly wouldn't shirk away from it. I think we could give it a good go.
Okay, and finally, is there a reliable method to predict fatigue failure in the bonded joint?
Well, again, this is where you really need to get back to basics and carry out fatigue experiments to basically define what the SN curve is for that particular adhesive system, and then use that as a basis for subsequent calculations. You really need those fundamental properties, which really can only be obtained by actually doing the work to have any level of confidence. But adhesives in general are very fatigue resistant. So if the system is designed effectively, as in the final structure, then adhesives should give you a good way to solve the problem. But you'd need to do the fatigue testing to get the data in order to make the predictions, the calculations.
Okay, you've answered all the questions. So thank you very much.
No, you're welcome. And thank you everyone who's still there for listening in. It's appreciated. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Shirin, and thank you to everyone that's been attending. And we will be sending out a copy of the recording and the presentation afterwards. So thank you.
Welcome.